So let's talk a little about AI and how we got to this exciting but also scary world of deepfakes. So over the last few years, there's been a massive democratization of AI. We've seen hardware costs dramatically decrease. We've seen software costs dramatically decrease, where we have a lot of software that is now free. We've seen inference costs go down by a factor of 100. We've seen over 10,000 products available on our desktops, on our phones. Typically, we're just a Google search away, where anybody without any AI experience or cybersecurity experience can make an incredibly entertaining video as you as your favorite actor, or perhaps something much more nefarious, things like non-consensual pornography, things like identity fraud, things that only are limited by our imaginations. Now, in previous years, emerging technologies took months, if not years, for adoption. But with generative AI, it's taking just days. Now let's talk about deepfakes in numbers. We're seeing over 1,700% increase in deepfakes in the US alone. And LexisNexis CEO forecast over $1 trillion of fraud will happen in the US over the next 12 months. Over a third of large companies are facing deepfakes fraud that they know about. There's a whole larger world what they don't know about. And we've seen the actual recognized increase of use of generative media within fraud increase tenfold since last year. Now let's talk about deepfakes in the news. Now, deepfakes and generative media, again, most use cases great, but in a dangerous world, we're hearing what appears to be our president telling us not to vote. We're hearing what appears to be doctors telling us not to get vaccinated. We're seeing deepfake non-consensual pornography of Taylor Swift and our loved ones. We're seeing high school students using what are called nudify applications to make women in their class appear nude. Regulations, they don't quite exist yet, but we'll talk about those in a moment. Now, countries, consumers, and everyone here will be facing deepfake challenges over the next few months if they haven't already. We're seeing elections outside the US actually change with deepfakes. In this one, a deepfake audio of a candidate appeared to say that he was going to increase the taxes on beer, which were just enough to actually change the election for the country. And now, for those of us with bank accounts or brokerage accounts, we've heard things like, your voice is your password. But now with over 10,000 voice cloning tools available for free, any of us can be deepfaked with less than 10 seconds of audio. Now let's talk about how to not identify deepfakes. If this was a year ago, we would have gone through a menu of solutions to look at symmetry, look at different types of anti-aliasing, look for sound versus mouth correlation, but in the last few months, it's gotten perfect. Two-thirds of my team at Reality Defender are PhD researchers or engineers, and they can't tell the difference. So folks like my parents and my children really don't stand a chance.
I am not Morgan Freeman, and what you see is not real. Well, at least in contemporary terms, it is not. What if I were to tell you that I am not even a human being? Would you believe me? What is your perception of reality?
Let's talk about how to identify deepfakes. Now, deepfakes are based on different generative AI models. And because traditional tools don't work anymore, we must use AI to detect AI.
AI-generated audio is now easier to make and harder to detect.
So as you think about AI-generated audio, but also video, and also images, to the trained or untrained eye or ear, there are really no artifacts that can point out. It's happening at a pixel layer. It's happening within the spectrogram within audio. Within text, a lot of great use cases of generative AI, but again, you can replicate almost anything just by asking a question. And what current tools and current platforms, in the face of no regulations, focus on what's called provenance, matching like for like, either a yes or a no. For those on social media, we might look for things like watermarks or fingerprints, or things like community notes. Now, sometimes they're correct. They say this item may be fake. They also may be wrong. And things like community notes only ever happen once something's been shared over a million times. So what we saw is what appeared to be an explosion at the Pentagon on social media, finally recognized as fake, only happened hours later when there was already a $100 billion flash crash in the market. And so while our current administration is focused on provenance as an initial solution, we think it's a good stepping stone, but it's not enough. Within our research at Reality Defender, we focus on inference. Now, for the math folks in the room, inference is probabilistic. It's never 100% because it assumes the original answer, the ground truth, may not ever exist. But it presupposes what's called a perimeter strategy, where the results we identify are just one of a number of factors to identify whether a person or a video or an audio clip may be AI-generated or manipulated. Now let's talk about regulations. There are no current federal regulations on generative AI fraud. There are a few local regulations at the state and city level, but they're more akin to reiterating what is already known as illegal. It might be like saying, it's illegal to rob a bank, even though laws already exist. What we're pushing for is akin to saying banks must have metal detectors, requiring the actual providers of services to protect consumers. We actually drafted our own law, our own regulatory proposal, that on one hand supports AI innovation, while on the other hand says that improper use of AI must be signified to indicate to you and your loved ones that a piece of media, an image, a photo, audio on Facebook may be AI generated, and then it might not go viral. And we gave testimony in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee last month. Now, what was fascinating was that you had people on the way left and way right come together on what is truly a bipartisan issue. And so we remain optimistic that in a year when two-thirds of the world is voting in an election, we hope, we pray, that some basic regulations will come out of it to protect us in what we imagine might be the most important election in our country and perhaps the world's history. Thank you guys so much. I'm Ben.